The following is a presentation of KGEM-TV, available on cable in Monrovia, California, and on the internet at www.kgem.tv.
Welcome to the show known as Beyond the Headlines. I'm your host, Ralph Walker, and over here at KGEM, we have a special edition. And what is it going to be focusing on? The March 6th election. That's right, you at home, circle the calendar. On March 6th, the alarm will go out for you to take someone to the election booth with you. Not necessarily in the same booth, but you get the message. All right, the first candidate that's running for a re-election, name that's quite familiar with most residents of Monrovia, is Tom Adams. I'm glad to have you here,
Ralph,
in the studio.
Appreciate the invitation again. Thank you.
All right, now some of the, I don't know how the population in Monrovia has grown. I'm pretty sure leaps and bounds. Every time I drive through the community, I see vast changes and different faces. Now, for some of the new viewers that may just be tuning in and wondering, elections in Monrovia, March 6th, Tom Adams, he's been on the city council for 12 years?
Yes, it'll be actually 13 in April.
A question they may ask, Tom Adams, how did you get involved in running for city council way back?
Way back when.
Yeah.
You're looking at the color of my hair again. you know, I just always had a keen interest in Monrovia. I was born in Monrovia, and although I grew up in San Gabriel, my parents moved to the house I grew up in when I was 6 months old. My wife and I came back to Monrovia, I want to say 32 years ago, I believe.
Okay.
And it just seemed to be a natural thing to do, to be involved in the community, concerned about the community. Part of that is my personality. Part of it is my vocation being in real estate. Mm-hmm. Naturally requires that you have an interest in the community, knowledge of the community. And as I became more and more involved, eventually I got on the Planning Commission and served almost 4 years there. And then some people that I respected very much in Monrovia asked me to run the first time.
Who were those people?
Jan Murug, I think, was the first one.
Okay.
Jan Murug, Jerry Murug, Joe Ragsdale, Pat Myers, some of the old-time Monrovians, mm-hmm. who have been involved in the community for decades.
Now, do you recall what issue, what particular thing that was the driving point in your campaign?
I don't know that there was an issue in particular. I do recall very well that John Nobrega, that I know mm-hmm. you know very well, had talked about retiring. And I knew John very well and had a great amount of respect for him. And I went to John and said, John, you know, if I don't want to run if you're running. And initially he said he didn't think he would and he wasn't sure. The long and boring story short, by the time I filed, John did decide to run. And so there was, I think, Laura Blakely and John Nobrega running for re-election. Mm-hmm. There was myself and I think four or five other candidates running. And I was successful.
And you've been there ever since?
I have.
All right, now let's fast forward and talk about this election.
Mm-hmm.
At one time, it was a very sensitive issue, at least to some folks, term limits. Remember when I was very popular, everyone was screaming, term limits after they're in there so long, get them out of there!
Yeah.
And I think Bob Bartlett used to always say, well, the term limit, the best thing you have is elections.
Yes.
That'll decide whether or not.
Yeah.
All right, 12 years later,
mm-hmm.
why are you still running?
You know, I think right now is such a very important time for Monrovia, and although there are no term limits in Monrovia, I have already stated in print that this will be my last term. So I'm
now, when you say in print,
the Star News.
Oh, the Star News.
In the Star
News. Fabulous Star News.
Yeah, the fabulous Star News. I don't know if you saw their editorial the other day, but we did have our interview with the editorial board 2 weeks ago. And I told them, and I have pretty much told everybody, and here I am on your show, this will be it. It will be time for someone a little younger with perhaps a little more energy to step into
that. Now, to the viewers that may not be privy about the Star News and the editorial board, what transpires there? What happens there?
All the candidates are invited down to be interviewed by a couple of members of the editorial board, and you go through an interview process and a little Q&A, and then, as is customary with most newspapers, they decide on a city-by-city basis who they will endorse for election.
A lot of power, huh?
You know, it's...
Or is it the kiss of death sometimes?
Well, it could be either. It's interesting, I did not get the endorsement from them the first time I ran, yet I was still successful. I'm not certain that I got it the second time. Actually, the second time we got a free pass. I don't know if you recall that, but no one filed against Laura and I that time. When I ran for mayor along with Laura, I did not get their endorsement then. But I did get it this time.
All right, now, is
it
something important? Is it something important to have, or does it really matter?
I don't think, you know, it's nice to have. Mm-hmm. Any endorsement that you can get, for the most part, is nice to have. But I don't think it makes or breaks candidacies. Clearly, not having it the first time, I was still successful. I think your commitment to the community, your connection with the community, is far more important than that. Particularly when you look at their circulation, clearly their circulation numbers do not cover the entire community. They don't speak for the community, the voters do.
Yes, yes. And the reason why I asked that question, and in doing shows like this, informing the residents of Monrovia, what candidates are running for office, because a lot of times someone may not run this particular time.
Right.
But this may be a window of opportunity for them to find out what they need to do to start running, and what is some of the contacts or some of the obstacles they need to jump over. Now, running as a candidate this time, what's the theme of your campaign? Do you have one?
Several things. You know, I said a moment ago, this is such an important time for Monrovia. When you look at everything that is changing in Monrovia today, it's probably more change than you and I will see for the rest of our lives. You know, we've got the downtown project, which hasn't happened in that scale in 30 years. We've got the Colorado Commons project, which is at the northeast corner of Colorado and Primrose. Huge development. Yeah. We've got the development on the Neff property, a big development downtown. And more importantly, we've got Station Square. And Station Square, as I'm sure you know, will be where the Gold Line comes through Monrovia. And it will go from Evergreen, or just south of the freeway, down to Duarte Road, and from Magnolia on the west all the way over to, I believe, Shamrock on the east. Huge development. It will literally create, to some degree, a sub-community within Monrovia. The plans are to have a hotel, obviously the light rail station, residential, retail, food service. It will be the largest single development in the San Gabriel Valley, I'm certain, for the rest of our lives.
All right, now when you use the term change, it's almost like take your medicine in some ways.
Well,
some people can adapt to change tremendously, and some people may have a tendency of fighting it.
Right.
When you talk about, for example, let's take the downtown project.
Yes.
With the sidewalks and beautification of that. Mm-hmm. There's some merchants that probably were a little ticked at the timing of it. And how does one react to that and change, that word that means so much to so many different people?
Well, change, I think, depends almost entirely on your personality. Some people are totally against change. I've had people...
Whether or not it's beneficial to
well,
the greater?
Well, some people don't see change as being beneficial to anyone. I've had some merchants tell me you shouldn't have done it now because of the holidays. I've had other merchants say don't do it during the summer because that's when I get my greatest business. Don't do it in good weather because that's when people are doing sidewalk dining. There's, I think, 228, I believe, very independently minded small business owners downtown, and to try to get them to agree on something is a little bit like herding cats. And it was time to do that. I'm sure you've seen over the years the patchwork that was done on the sidewalks now. All the drains that ran underneath the sidewalks out to the gutters we've been having problems with for years.
So infrastructure.
It was 30 years old. It was time for a change. So then the only question is, when do you do it and how do you do it? The good news is we didn't borrow any money to do that. We did that out of reserves and grants. It will completely replace all of the hardscape, all of the landscape, all of the wheelchair ramps. I'm sure you've seen the ADA ramping that's down there now. It's interesting. I had a lot of complaints about the yellow ramps.
Oh, yes.
And I didn't know initially, and I've since found out, and it makes perfect sense that, number one, the ramps are there for to help people in wheelchairs and walkers, and the yellow pads with the bumps are there for people who walk with a cane, those okay. without sight, because they can feel those bumps, and that's the caution to them that you're entering the street. And the bright yellow is a caution for those that are partially sighted to warn them that you're about to enter the street. So it's the Americans with Disabilities Act that requires these types of things.
And that color is universal. It's not like each city has a different color, right?
There were some other options. That is the color that I think just about every city is going to because it is universally mm-hmm. caution.
Yeah, yeah.
So when you look at all of those changes, you know, at some point you have to fix things.
Right.
It's interesting that I read so many cities, the complaints are nobody ever fix anything. They don't fix their sidewalks, they don't fix the potholes, right. And here we are fixing literally everything, and you still get complaints about it, but then you move forward and do what you think is right.
Now how is this election for you different? Other than it's being the last time that you're going through this process, interviewing mm-hmm. and talking to different people, do you do anything different? Or
well, for
was
me,
it in the bag? Some of the viewers out there may well, hey, man, you know it's in the bag. Is it in the bag? Or is it ever in the bag?
I don't know that it's ever in the bag. You know, I think people get unelected because they think it's in the bag.
Mm-hmm.
I feel very comfortable this time. I think that I've spent the last 16 years, I think, doing a good job for Monrovia. I think Monrovia thinks I'm doing a good job for them. I truly know that my heart is in the right place, and that doesn't mean that people don't make honest mistakes. But I think, you know, I've watched intently at our council meetings over the past several years, and although we occasionally get people during public comment complain about some things, what's fascinating is when you get down to spend $40 million, we're going to adopt our budget. We never have one complaint. And to me, that's a testament that the people have that much faith in us, although they may occasionally like to complain about things.
And which is easy to do.
Well, it is easy to do. We're big targets. And that doesn't mean that we're always right, because we're not. We're human.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still government. And government, just by its nature, is sometimes wrong. But when you get down to spend the $40 million, we never have one person step up and say we're going in the wrong direction. And I believe that's because most people think we are going in the right direction. Change is still tough for some folks.
Mm-hmm.
The interesting thing, if you go back to Monrovia in the late 50s, early 60s, some people thought they could hold Monrovia still and let the rest of the world move forward, and you can't. You're either going forward or you're going backwards. And some very bright people 30 years ago set out with a plan to turn Monrovia around. They did a great job then. What's fascinating is how many people have moved to Monrovia in the last 10, 15 years that don't remember Airport Liquor.
Now that's a good point that you're going on there. The new Monrovia.
Yes.
And the old Monrovia.
Yes.
What is their common thread? What is their common bond that one can use as a bridge for both of them? Because like you say, some don't have a clue of what Monrovia was like 30 years ago.
Right. Well, the common thread is they love Monrovia, that they still think this is a great place to live in and raise their families in. And although the newer Monrovians don't know how bad it was 30 or 35 years ago, that doesn't mean that we take our eye off the ball for the future. And I'll tell you the best example I can give you, and you remember Joe Santoro, who was our police chief. I think the chief prior to Joe had become very comfortable in Monrovia. And Joe came in with a new set of eyes and said, hey, wait a minute, this has got to change. And that's why I think at the end of this four-year term, it will be time for me to. Because I think it's important for Monrovia to occasionally get those different sets of eyes looking at things.
All right, now when you decide, after you made that decision, okay, this is it, do you look for someone to that maybe has your vision or your same political thought?
No.
To
pick my successor?
Yes.
No. No, I think that's...
Come on, be real now.
I am being very real.
Okay.
I've had people tell me, well, you need to pick someone to replace you. That's the community's job. You know, you had Tom Adams for 12 years. It will be 16 by the time this term is up. At four on the Planning Commission, you've had Tom Adams for 20 years.
Wow.
It's time to get someone else. And that doesn't mean that I've lost it. It doesn't mean that my opinion isn't valuable. What that means is every now and then you need to freshen things up a little bit. And I think that's important to do. I don't think it's my job to hand pick someone. I think very strongly that by telling the community now,
okay,
that in 4 years my seat will be open, this gives people more than enough opportunity for them to decide who should run for it, and then I'll get a chance, as does every other Monrovian, to vote for that successor,
okay,
and to perhaps even endorse one. But for me, me grooming my replacement, no.
Okay, all right. Just had to ask that question.
I'm glad you did.
All right, that'll be interesting to see. Who knocks on your door saying, embrace me,
yeah.
I have Tom Adams' support and he's with me and along that line. Let's talk about some other changes.
Yes.
That's probably on the tip of everyone's tongue, and that's the library. And that is tremendous in itself.
It is tremendous.
That measure for the voters to decide on what they're going to do, measure L.
And I feel very strongly that we need to vote for this. And it's interesting because I don't like paying any more taxes than anybody does. I don't view this as a cost. I view it as an investment. And it's an investment in our town. You know, my children are now 26 and soon to be 28. Went to Mayflower School, Clifton, Monrovia High, from kindergarten all the way through. And my wife and I would take them to the Arcadia Library frequently because the Monrovia Library didn't suit their needs. I know our school libraries are facing funding problems, and these are still our children. You know, it would be real easy for the city council or the city or the citizens to say, well, the school should take care of this. This is a community problem. It's a community issue, and I don't believe that you will ever have a great community until you have a great library. And our library, everyone who works there does a great job. They're doing the best they can with what they have. The building is time for it to go away.
Oh, overdue.
Way overdue.
It's overdue. I've taken tours through there.
Yeah.
To show the community the inadequate space.
Yes.
Lack of space and
lack of space, lack of technology, lack of infrastructure to support the technology. The Hoffman family from Sierra Auto Cars is standing there ready, willing, and able to give us, I believe, $250,000. But we need the place to put it.
Right.
So, you know, we tried to get state money for years. That's not coming. The Hoffman family, as they always have been, very supportive of Monrovia, is stepping up to the plate. But we still need a good facility. We need a facility that will suit the needs of not just you and I, our students, our children, the new technology. This building will do it. And the great thing about this financing is this is fixed. It's not on assessed valuation. It's so many dollars per household. So, excuse me, as inexpensive as it is today, mm-hmm. 10 years from now, it's even cheaper. So in time, it will become that much easier for the community to pay for. I would encourage everyone to vote for it. I think it's a great opportunity to really move our community up a notch.
All right, if you just tune in and you're wondering what's going on, this is a special edition of Beyond the Headlines. We're focusing on candidates running for political office in the city of Monrovia. Incumbent right here, Tom Adams, seeking, he says, his last term. We'll find out. But right now, let's talk about the changes. And with all these changes and all these spaces coming up, there's going to be filled in with people. Where are all the cars going to go?
Well, and that's the interesting part. And it is interesting that when we look at all of the change that's taken place to date, our population has not grown that much.
Yeah, that's right. Population, like 39,000?
38 and change.
Okay.
But what's fascinating is periodically we will actually see someone tear down 6 units and replace it with 4. Tear down 1 and replace it with 2. So when you look at the net addition of living spaces, it really has not increased that much. The one thing that will change that a lot is Station Square. But it's doing that intentionally.
How is it going to change that?
Well, there'll be a lot of residential units down there. We don't have an exact number because we don't have an exact plan yet. But it's going to be a substantial increase. But this is designed to be a commuter community.
Which is the trend towards the future,
yes,
no matter where you live at.
Well,
emphasis is on transportation.
Yes. The whole design, when you look at Colorado Commons, when you look at the development over the Neff property, this is designed to have more people who can walk around downtown that don't have to drive around downtown. You know, it's interesting, when you look at our downtown and you go back to the turn of the century, 1910, 1920, many of those buildings were designed to have living spaces upstairs.
Right.
And then the world became sophisticated and we thought, well, this just isn't appropriate, so we don't want people living downtown. Mm-hmm. And then over years, the downtown started to die. Shoppers got pulled away to the malls and shopping centers. And we now realize that it's good to have people downtown. It's good for business, it's good for the people. Our weather in Southern California supports it unbelievably well. When you look at the lifestyle of people that live in New York,
Chicago,
your hometown, with their transportation and the pedestrian traffics. So these two new developments are designed to allow people to live downtown, maybe work downtown, shop downtown, and do it all on foot. The new development down at Station Square, where the Gold Line's going, is designed for those folks to use that Gold Line as their transportation, to eat in the restaurants that will be there, to shop in the stores that are there, and the little trolley that we have is planning on running between Station Square and downtown. So there'll be a natural connection between those two, hopefully without creating any more real traffic for
now,
us.
Is there a battle to get people out of the car and onto public transportation. I know if you're from New York, or if you're from Chicago, if you're any place where there's a large metro transportation, yeah. You love it.
Not only love it, well, it's normal. I have a friend, colleague of mine from New York, who has a 26-year-old daughter who doesn't even have a driver's license. The girl has grown up in New York, ridden public transportation her entire life, has never driven a car, and that is very normal for her.
Right.
I think what we will see, a couple things with the Gold Line, and Rob Hammond stays on top of that probably better than any of us. But until the Gold Line goes all the way out, it'll never be maximized.
Oh, okay.
It needs to have a destination. When that happens, and it may not be my generation, but my kids will, and their children will grow up thinking this is normal. This is changing a mindset. You know, we've all grown up in Southern California thinking cars were the end all, and it's gives you a real sense of freedom. But there are so many of them now that light rail is going to be the thing of the future. You know, you think back to the expansion of our nation, and you look at originally the cities were on the coast because ships could get there. And then they were on rivers because boats could get there. And then they moved to the rail because that's what brought everybody. And then they moved to the freeways, and now they're going to be shifting to light rail, the Metrolink. This is where the population needs to be. So when you look at this new little population center down on the Gold Line, is going to be surrounded by light rail transportation, a main thoroughfare, and the freeway three blocks away. So it shouldn't impact the rest of the community. I think it's very well planned.
All right. Now, what is some of the biggest challenges of being a city council person? What is some of the details that the job requires that one might not even realize it after one sits in that chair and says, okay, this is what it's all about?
You know, I think the biggest challenge is, and it showed up at a public hearing we had a few weeks ago, and it was really a dispute between a couple of property owners. And I marvel at, over the years, how quick some people are to tell their neighbor what to do, but they don't want that neighbor telling them what to do. People that think that government's role is there to, you know, punish the guy next door, but not me. And it's getting that balance, and these are very real feelings for people that want to tell their neighbor what to do. And what I always remind people is we're still a country of laws, and that's what we all take an oath to follow, is to follow the laws, the U.S. Constitution, the state constitution, and the Monrovia Municipal Code. And that there are times when you have to look out into the audience to someone that you know and like and tell them, sorry, but we're voting against you. Because it's the right thing to do. And sometimes government is there. You know, sometimes you'll have a public hearing where there'll be 30 people in the audience and they think that somehow their numbers should overwhelm you. And we still have laws. And sometimes government is there to protect that one individual, that minority viewpoint, from the majority. Because if you take out laws and you go back to who shows up at the hearing with the most guns, as in the Old West.
Mob rule.
Well, exactly. And not everyone understands that they think, well, you know, we've brought this petition forward and there's 50 signatures on it, so you need to do what we want. And sometimes you have to tell people that are very close to you, you know, I'm sorry, but we still have a law and we have to follow that. And this person has rights.
Now, have you ever had, I know you've had situations like that where it may even alter a friendship. It can get to that point, right?
It could. It shouldn't. It shouldn't. Because if you're really friends with somebody, friendship should go over all of that. But I have had one person who indicated to me that they could no longer be my friend because of a position I took. And I looked at them and I said, you know, I'm really sorry you feel that way. But if you feel that way, then you really weren't my friend to begin with. Because my real friends understand. And my real friends respect the times that we disagree on things, and they're still my friends.
All right, now, how do you respond to someone that might say, oh, Tom Adams is in real estate? Sure, he loves the boom, boom, boom in real estate going on, and because it's to his advantage. I mean, I know if you've heard this. I mean, it's not like something I'm just putting out there, but I'm pretty sure you heard that before.
Oh, I have.
How does one city council seat and void that conflict of interest? So how does one keep that separate from what's happening?
Well, the conflict of interest laws are very clear-cut in California, and I follow those to the letter. If there's ever any question, I always check with the city attorney, and if there's any gray area, I always abstain from voting on it. What I have said and what I will continue to say to people that think that because I'm in real estate, I want all development, is that I was the one who, at the public hearing, said to all the people who didn't want the hillsides developed, let's put it to a vote of the people. Mm-hmm. And if we all work together, we can buy this. I think I wrote them either their first or their second $1,000 check to the campaign to purchase the hillsides. So anybody who says, because Tom's in real estate, mm-hmm. and I love development, not always. I try to do what I think is good for the community, because when the day's done, before I got into real estate, long after I retire, this is still my home.
Good point.
Yeah.
Good point. All right, now some of the viewers out there are probably wondering, what is the fun part of the job? What's the part of the job that brings a delight to you, end of the day, end of a week, or?
You know, the fun part is seeing change, because change can be fun. And a classic example is, for many years, City Hall was closed on Friday.
Oh, yeah.
It's open on Friday.
That was part of the budget cutting, I believe it was.
Well, that's what they called it.
Okay. Tighten the belt buckles.
That's what they called it.
Yeah.
It brought me a great amount of personal pleasure to see City Hall reopen on Friday. It brings me a great amount of personal pleasure to tell people that our City Hall is open 55 hours a week.
Now, what is there someone out there that's probably wondering, well, I thought it was closed, and you're telling me it's open. What's the advantage to having City Hall open?
It's service. It's service. You know, we are public servants, and you're the public, and of course, I'm in a service industry, so I feel very strongly that service is the most important thing we can do. Other than water, we don't have a product we sell.
Oh, yeah.
All we can do is provide service to the people who elect us. And at a time when the federal government's broke, the state government's broke, LA County's broke, cities, by and large, are having a lot of problems, mm-hmm. Monrovia took a four-day-a-week operation, not only expanded it to 5 days, Monday through Friday, every week, but it's open 55 hours a week. So it opens at 7 o'clock in the morning, it closes at 6 o'clock at night, 5 days a week. There's, to my knowledge, not another governmental office that's open that much. And now we're looking at the possibility of opening on Saturday. Because when the day is done, this is civil service.
Oh, yeah.
This is about providing service to ourselves, our neighbors, our friends.
Which would be a tremendous plus for working people that maybe can't make it there Friday at that particular time.
Or, you know, everybody's working harder than, I think back when I grew up, and you and I are pretty close to the same age. You know, my dad had a 40-hour work week, and my mom was a stay-at-home mom. And you look at the world today, and of the homes that are fortunate enough to have two parents at home, typically they're both working, and they're both working very hard, and there's a lot going on in their life. And anything we can do to lighten that load, I think, is a good thing. So we're going to look at it. That will involve some cost. And the first thing we need to do is find out if the public wants that. I don't think I'm smart enough to know what everybody wants. Mm-hmm. So we're going to do some polling and see if people will view that as beneficial.
Venture out in the community and tap on the polls and see what.
And that's the kind of thing that I really enjoy is trying to make things better. And I don't know anyone who can look at that and say, we didn't do a good job. You may not like the color of the wheelchair ramps downtown. Mm-hmm. You may not like the lights. You may not like the trees we chose. But here's a level of service that I don't know that another city anywhere provides that.
Not anywhere. In recent times.
No.
I think Monrovia, so often in the past, was probably in the shadows of Arcadia, Man, Pasadena.
Yeah.
But now, the sun seems to be shining brightly in the city of
Very
Monrovia
bright.
In more ways than one. Now, you mentioned the NEF building.
Yes.
What's going to take place there?
That is it will be a multi-level, mixed-use building with its own internal parking structure.
Oh, so anything that happens there will have its own parking in and out.
Yes. And parking's interesting. Matter of fact, we have a parking study going on right now. We have 10 citizens in Monrovia who volunteered to serve on an ad hoc committee to look at parking. Monrovia is the fourth oldest city in Los Angeles County. Many of our lots and homes and streets mm-hmm. were built for Model Ts back at a time when families had one car, maybe, and now we have families with three and four cars. What's fascinating is the new development rarely ever creates the parking problem. The parking problem has been here forever.
Mm.
It's just that we've evolved, our families have evolved into multi-car families, and our properties haven't. So when you drive up Myrtle Avenue north of Foothill and you see those cute little bungalows that were built in 1920, originally, for the most part, they would have had a one-car garage,
yes.
and they would have had a Model T, maybe. Not all families had cars. There's still a couple houses in town that still have the carriage house from when they had wagons with a loft upstairs mm-hmm. for the hay. So we've evolved, and a lot of the community hasn't. And our goal is to make sure that everything we do is more than adequate enough for its parking needs. We can't go back and change what happened 100 years ago, but we can change tomorrow.
All right, now, when fast forward in some ways, when people reflect back on Tom Adams, what is the thing that you want them to remember the most?
That I was a good dad. I told you a moment ago, my daughter gave me the shirt, and I forgot where I was going to be tonight, and I put this on. But
what is great.
You know,
it's good.
This is a great job being on the city council. The pay's not very good, but I love it. I love Monrovia. I love what I do for a living. But when the day is done, if people will know that I was a good dad, that's more important than all the rest of it combined. A good husband and a good father.
All right, and that carries over probably into the way you do your job at work also.
Yeah, I tried to.
In many ways.
Because I try to be fair with people. Stern, perhaps. But I think it's good.
I think we grew up that way.
Yeah.
I'm glad you touched on that, too, because how, you know, it's a national crisis in getting young people involved in the political process. That's a reality. Something is being lost because somehow we're not conveying over to them the importance of the ballot.
Right.
And if you don't do it at the community level, you won't do it on the national level.
And that's so interesting when you look at the number of people who will vote for a national election who won't vote for a municipal election.
Something close at home.
And it is amazing because this is the only level of government that really cares.
That's going to impact you.
Yeah. The average person, you and I, call up your congressman. Well, you know, I might get a call returned because I'm on the council.
Congressman's calling you.
Yeah, but but when the day's done, this is the level that people really care. I mean, when I go into the grocery store, I see the people I work for.
Yeah.
When I go to get gas, when I go to a restaurant, I see people that I work for. I see the voters of Monrovia.
And they hold you personally responsible.
They do. And I don't think you can find any level of government that really cares as much as you do locally. I marvel at people not coming down to the council meeting. Part of that tells me they trust us, mm-hmm. but I think part of that may be because they don't care. Maybe they're too busy, I'm not sure. But what I would tell people is, even if you don't vote on the national election, you should vote on the local election, because this is where it really matters. This is where we can change how you park your car. And you can tell us what you think of it. And you can't do that anywhere else. I think politics, to some degree, particularly on a national level, has lost sight of who we are and why they're there.
Right.
And this is still Monrovia, and we're all still Monrovians when the day is done.
All right, now they tell me the hands of time are moving rather quickly.
Is it?
It is almost that time.
Oh, my goodness.
And, you know, and it happens like that when you get into a groove and you're talking about something that you hold very special,
yeah.
being a servant of the people, a phrase that sometimes elected officials forget sometimes who they really are the servant of, and they really are the servant of the people, but it's important that the people remind them periodically.
Absolutely.
That, okay, you work for me.
Yes.
You're the person that I'm relying to make this happen. And if it's not to happen for some reason, you should be able to come back to me, communicate to me why it's not for the vested future of the majority and 9 times out of 10. So I'm gonna let you face the camera and talk to the people out there and let them know why they should vote for you, Tom Adams, one more time.
Well, I do believe in community support. I do believe in community service. I believe in municipal service, civil service, call it any way you want. There's a reason I keep all my contact information in the phone book. My phone number's there. I think most people know where I work and how to contact me. And you'd be amazed how many people call, walk into my office, and want to talk about a problem. And I encourage that. And what's fascinating about the people in this town is they never abuse it. People only come down when they really think they have an issue.
Now I can imagine there's some of you out there, what's his phone number? I didn't know you could call him.
My phone number, 626. This is my direct line.
Okay.
626-930-9317.
One more time.
626-930-9317. Go straight to my desk. I've always encouraged people to call me if there's a problem. Sometimes I'll have friends say, well, I didn't want to bother you.
Right.
Well, that's kind of why we're there. And we all ask for this job. Everybody who runs for office not only asks for it, but they go out and they fight to be in this yeah. position. And if you're going to fight to be in this position, you need to realize that serving the people that you asked to vote for you is why you're supposed to be there. So I've always encouraged people to call me, no matter what the issue is. Sometimes, as good as the people are at City Hall, and they're fabulous, sometimes it's just knowing how to get through
the maze.
The maze, the departments, mm-hmm. and sometimes we can speed that process up. Doesn't mean we get any favors, but we know who to call.
All right, now we in many ways, this is like the golden age of Monrovia. We're living in it.
It is.
We're looking at it. We're seeing it develop right in front of our
yeah.
eyes. What is a challenge that you see? Sometimes when all the glitter is happening, there's always sometimes a problem underneath or somewhere around.
Well, in many ways, Monrovia is a victim of its own success. 30 years ago, you could buy anything in Monrovia for anything you wanted and redevelop it. And when you're on the bottom, you have nowhere to go but up. We have an entirely new group of people moving into town. that maybe view things a little differently and they don't know that past. And I think it's important to know where you came from so you know where you need to go. You can't have one without the other.
All right, if you just tune in, this is a series of several interviews that are going to be taking place with various candidates running for political office in the city of Monrovia. I'm honored to have here today Tom Adams seeking another term on the city council. There will be others, the mayor. So don't hesitate to tune in and get some valuable information for that very special day, March 6th. And don't forget, take a friend with you.